see. You want a corner seat?
Good evening. It's nice to see so many faces here at Lunar and Planetary Science Conference. I was contemplating whether or not I needed to introduce myself, but there's enough new faces and young people in the room. I'm Eileen Stansberry. I'm the chief scientist at NASA's Johnson Space Center, one of the co-conveners, and me and my co-convener, Louise Proctor, the director of the Lunar and Planetary Institute, welcome you to the 48th Annual Lunar and Planetary Science Conference. It has been a long-standing tradition here at LPSC to provide an opportunity to hear from our NASA headquarters, Science Mission Directorate, and this year the Human Exploration and Operations Mission Directorate colleagues to talk to us about the current status and plans for NASA headquarters. And so I'm going to introduce Dr. Jim Green, who is going to talk about the Planetary Science Division at NASA headquarters.
Thank you very much, Eileen. So it's really wonderful, of course, to be in Texas, talk about what's happening in planetary science. So the outline of my talk today is all about talking about the budget, talk about some of our mission events, things that we're looking forward to, give everybody an update on the senior review, what may happen also a little bit in the future, touch our programs, our mission programs, and then talk about some of the exciting upcoming opportunities. There's actually a couple announcements I want to give today. And then we'll talk about the advisory structure changes in NASA and a little bit about the studies and schedules for the National Academy that affect planetary science. I do want to mention that we're only lightly going to talk about RNA today, but the RNA Town Hall is Wednesday over the noon hour in Waterway 6 through 8, I guess. And so please attend. Okay. Let's first talk about the planetary science budget. You know, I've been at NASA headquarters 11 years, and I've been waiting for the opportunity to talk about the planetary budget in a tremendously positive way. So I see that more people have actually attended my previous talks. I've always been positive, but indeed the budget we're going to talk about is incredibly good. When we look at the overall president's budget, this comes out of the Washington Post, what we see NASA at $19.1 billion is down just a little bit from the last fiscal year, what's called, the fiscal year we're in, FY17. So this is the president's budget, President Trump's budget given to Congress. And so NASA really fared incredibly well. So how well did planetary fare? Well, overall in the budget, human exploration got $3.7 billion in support of the Space Launch System. You know, this is an incredibly important step for them. You know, we've been talking about using the SLS, so it's also an incredibly important step for us. Planetary science in the president's budget is being proposed to Congress at $1.9 billion. That's a 16% increase above this fiscal year. This is historic. You know, we've never had a proposed budget this high. This also is the highest increase in any organization at NASA for this year. And when I look across the room, I know who to blame. It's really what we've done in planetary science. The fabulous discoveries and our opportunity and ability to communicate those to the public and bring them along and share the excitement. And I think this is really just the start, and the administration really recognizes that, and I think the budget tells you that. This will allow us to move ahead with the program, and I'm going to talk about all the elements of that program the rest of my talk. There's also a little confusion that's going on in the proposed budget by the president for education. There's an education office that handles a variety of things. Some may know about those. They're typically like the Space Grant Consortiums, and they have a number of other things that they handle. And it's being zeroed out in the president's budget. But this is not the Science Mission Directorate's education budget. So I just want everyone to know that. It's a completely different budget. Also, there's a further breakdown that's going to come out later on, but this is indeed the top-level set of information that's currently available. And then currently we're under what's called a continuing resolution until April 28th. So Congress will have to get together, pass a budget that will either be a continuing resolution to the end of the year or a appropriated budget for us to operate on. So we're eagerly awaiting April 28th. That's be the next major budget deadline. All right, planetary science events. These are just the top level of mission events that are tremendously important for us to keep our eye on. Of course, what's really critical this year is what will happen to Cassini. I'll talk a little bit more about that. It's going through its grand finale orbits. Also, OSIRIS-REx does an Earth flyby, gives it a gravitational assist that allows that mission in 2018 to get to Bennu. In 2018, we'll launch InSight to Mars and land it. And then in 2019, New Horizons will fly by MU69 on January 1st. So we have a set of really exciting things that are coming up for us from our missions. Talk very briefly about the senior review. This is perhaps old news, but we go through a senior review every 2 years. The top recommendation is that the panel unanimously believes that all these missions should be extended. Although the rankings vary from excellent to good, these are all top missions that we want to continue. And we hope that they remain healthy as their fuel eventually runs out, and we'll have to drop some of these over the next several years, of course. So that's really good news. The authorization bill for NASA has been passed, and in that authorization bill it stated that senior reviews will be every 3 years. Although we've approved, based on the senior review last year, a two-year extension, at that next review, we'll then be working at a three-year cadence, and that's really much appreciated. Yeah. This was a National Academy recommendation. We put together a charge for the Academy. They reviewed it, and they believed that that would be the right cadence, and we couldn't agree more. So that's an important step for us. Let's go through our competed programs. In Discovery, we've announced two new missions, and the PIs are one of the PIs I've seen today, Psyche. There she is. Please stand up. Lindy. And, of course, Psyche, the mission is going to the fabulous asteroid Psyche. And then Hal Leveson. I don't think Hal, I had seen him, but anyway, Lucy is going to the Trojans. It's going to visit five Trojans in addition to an encounter of one of the asteroids in the asteroid belt. So pretty spectacular missions as we have selected those and move forward. These missions have been selected for flight. Okay. We also selected for an extended phase A, the NEOCAM mission. This allows us to continue its maturation and really get to a better concept. So it has a one-year extension. That's an important step for us. The New Frontiers program. In our three missions, I want to talk about each one of those. New Horizons, of course, has been approved through the last senior review. to go on to MU-69. You know, this is a 30 or so mile little Kuiper Belt object, really a building block of Pluto, is how we've expressed it. And that encounter will take place January 1st, 2019. So it'll be a really good start of that year. We're also planning, as we begin now working with the IAU, to begin to work on a naming contest, a naming activity, and more details of that will follow. So that's really exciting coming up. Also, Juno this last year got in orbit at Jupiter, and the initial set of orbits were 53 days. The hope was to get it down to 14 days. And we took the opportunity after a couple of these orbits, had an anomaly in one of the science orbits, and it didn't allow it to take data during that time period. And it allowed us to really step back and look at what observations were being made based on its current structure, that 53-day orbit. And we've decided to keep it in the 53-day orbit. It can complete its minimum science during its prime mission, and then it will go into the extended mission set. It also brings in a richer set of science. As you can see from the orbit details, having it move through the magnetotail of Jupiter, looking at the lobe structure, also the magnetopause, a little bit on the bow shock, and also those field lines that are connecting to the aurora, what field lines are really connected back out into the solar wind and separating the aurora that's induced by the internal convection versus the solar wind, we'll have a much better set of observations. This means we're going to hold the participating scientist contest and go through that. That call we're working on right now, and it will be joint with heliophysics. So we're going to bring on some planetary scientists and some heliophysics scientists and complement this mission, and I think that's a huge step for us to continue to not only work together, but take a major advantage of the architecture of this mission being in a really great orbit for us. OSIRIS-REx also launched this last year, moving towards Bennu. It just went through an opportunity where it had passed by L4, had the opportunity to take a good look for Earth Trojans, and that data is under analysis, and no announcement's been made yet, but hopefully they'll be able to announce something. We'll see. Also, the next step in the New Frontiers call, New Frontiers 4, in addition to the list of investigations we're going after, I also want to point out that this call is out, of course, in April 28th, the day our budget runs out or when all the proposals are due. Just coincidence, trust me. For Mars, quite a bit of activity is going on. We're pointing towards getting InSight ready to be launched in 18th and land in 2018. But 2020 seems to be quite the traffic jam, so to speak. You know, so when our opportunity opens up and that highway to Mars will get filled, it will not only be with the 2020 rover, but ESA's planning their ExoMars rover, which we have a major part of an experiment that we work with DLR on. China has announced that they want to land on Mars in 2020, so there'll be some sort of Chinese rover. And then just recently announced, Elon Musk says he wants to put a Red Dragon down on the surface of Mars in 2020. And this is a move from 2018. Now, this gives us a little more time. We have been working with Elon through our Space Act agreement, and I think that discussion in the next year may bring us to the point of saying that we will participate perhaps with an experiment on this particular Red Dragon. We'll see. Can't promise you, but we want to continue that discussion. We want to be able to take advantage of rides to Mars that the commercial sector does. And I think this is will be our first opportunity to be able to investigate that more thoroughly. Also, the UAE has a mission called HOPE, and that mission will also go in 2020. That seems to be also on time. So 2020 will be very, very busy. What's happened this last couple months has been the site selection workshop for Mars 2020. They were considering 8 major sites. That's now been down selected to 3, Northeast Syrtis Major, Jezero Crater, and Columbia Hills, or where Gusev Crater is, that Spirit had the opportunity to look at and in great detail. These are fabulous sites. I mean, the extensive mineralogy at Jezero, also the hydrated minerals, Northeast Syrtis is beautiful, and then a lot of carbonates, of course, in Columbia Hills. We'll continue to gather more data, and don't know what exactly the time scale is, but soon we'll be presenting these to the selecting official, who will be Thomas Zurbuchen, to be able to down select to one site, and that will be the site for 2020. So that's coming up in the next year and a half to 2 years. Outer Planets Program. Here's an overview of our Cassini orbits, and as you can see, some of these really great nodal areas are where Titan has been, and we've used those to change Cassini's plane, change the characteristics of its orbit, and so Titan is giving us really great gifts of being able to really take a good look at the Saturnian system. Currently, we're in this outer orbit, the one that just goes outside the rings, and fabulous observations that are coming back from Pan. If you've seen Pan, just a beautiful little ravioli-looking moon that must be gathering ring material as it's trying to cross the gap. And then Titan's last gift will be its last gravitational assist that will occur on April 22nd, allowing Cassini to once again decrease its perigee and get down between the first ring and the cloud tops, doing pretty much the same orbit in structure as Juno. This will allow all kinds of different science and allow us to compare the structures of these two bodies, not only from a gravity perspective, but also from a detailed magnetic field perspective and many other measurements that can be made. The Europa Clipper now is well situated in the president's budget. This is on track for a launch in early 2020. It's a fabulous mission. It actually orbits Jupiter, as we all know, but it does multiple flybys of Europa, just like Cassini did with Titan. It's designed really to take an extensive global view of Europa, allowing us to get a good look at its ice shell, the composition, the geology, and also with its high-resolution imaging, the ability to look for locations, potentially a future mission such as a Europa lander. Now, Sunday, there was a major town hall talking about the Science Definition Team report on the Europa lander mission. And I want to thank that Science Definition Team because the report's really a pretty spectacular report. I'll talk a little bit about it coming up. We also have nearing the completion of several mission studies. The Ice Giant study that goes that talks about opportunities going to Uranus and Neptune. The town hall for that is today. That happened at noon. Is that right? I missed that. Okay, shoot. So hopefully you were able to see that. Fortunately, I know what they're going to talk about. So it has a number of astounding things about our ability to get out to the outer solar system. One of the things that we tasked them to do was to take a look at this mission and how it could be facilitated using potentially the SLS. That can be a real game changer in many ways. And so it's, it gives us really an exciting opportunity. Also looks at potentially what technologies we need to develop and get ready for a potential ice giant mission in our future. Of course, the Europa Science Definition team, their town hall was Sunday. And another town hall is going to occur at AbSciCon on April 23rd. So if you're at AbSciCon and you missed this one, you want to know more about it. The science definition team did, they were what I would call overachievers. I mean, in a way, this is a beautiful report. They really got together and did an extensive analysis. They took lessons learned from Viking. They really did an outstanding job trying to understand the kind of measurements one wants to make if you're going after some really tough questions, you know, such as searching for the evidence of life, assessing the habitability and characterizing surface and subsurface. So I would encourage you to take a look at that report. It's really spectacular. And once again, thanks to all that were involved in the science definition team. I want to make several announcements. Well, I want to first start with a new set of activities that we're doing in the Science Mission Directorate. And this is extremely important. And it's really all about CubeSats and SmallSats. Now, a year or so ago, a report came out from the National Academy that we had tasked, and that was really taking a look at CubeSats and their applicability to our science. Now, many of you may know that planetary science was one of the first disciplines that had a CubeSat called Orioles. It's still orbiting. A mission that we launched in 2007 or 8 time frame, as I remember. But, you know, planetary CubeSats are kind of difficult. Further you are away, communication difficulties, power difficulties, there's a number of problems that arise from that. But we shouldn't be afraid of that. We need to go at that and figure out what are the technologies that we really need to go after to be able to make them a viable set of missions. Now, what came out of this report, the National Academy report last year, was that indeed CubeSats are very useful investigation tools to do important science. In particular, CubeSats are useful for targeted investigations to augment the capability of larger missions. And that is in order to make what we believe are highly specific measurements. This is a paradigm that I think fits really well with planetary science, where we actually have a larger mission with some associated CubeSats. The CubeSats can go to locations that we wouldn't take a larger mission, take on greater risk, make a variety of important measurements, and have its communication capability right there with it by communicating back to the larger mission. So that's an important paradigm. I think we want to continue to look at and study how that might be used in our future mission architectures. Also, the report talked about constellations, and constellations are probably more important in heliophysics and some of the other fields, and not necessarily so in planetary science, but certainly something we should look at and consider. So the Science Mission Directorate is moving forward, and I think in an aggressive way, to develop a directorate-wide approach. Now, what's important is, as other disciplines, like earth science and heliophysics, and even in astrophysics, develop a variety of instrumentation for CubeSats, we can leverage those developments. Okay, so that's an investment that's being made by other disciplines that we could potentially use. That's important for us to stay abreast of and keep that in mind as potential opportunities come up in this area. So in SMD, we want to identify high-priority science objectives in each of these disciplines, and that means planetary, that can be addressed through CubeSats and SmallSats. So we're going to be asking the AGs as they continue on with their road mapping to be able to identify those key science areas. We're also going to manage these programs with the appropriate cost and risk. You know, part of the success that NASA has is the ability to manage based on the cost of the mission and the type of mission we have. And these missions, which are designed to be fast, designed also to help develop the next generation of scientists in our field, don't need to be as thoroughly reviewed and have as much documentation as some of our larger missions. And so that's what the appropriate cost and risk is all about in terms of how we would manage those. We want to establish a multi-discipline approach and collaboration that helps science teams learn from experiences and grow capability while avoiding unnecessary duplication. So once again, this is an example where we would take advantage of things that are being developed in other disciplines. And then we also want to leverage what's happening in the commercial sector. You know, so as I mentioned earlier, as Elon Musk treks out, goes to Mars, here's a potential opportunity that might be able to take a planetary CubeSat or something with it in that venue. We'll have to see. But in any event, we want to take advantage of the commercial sector activities. Could also be the moon for that matter. So we had started a process already to begin to invest in some of these ideas and concepts. And as you know, last year, we put out a call. We call it the Planetary Science Deep Space Small Sat Study. And we had 102 proposals, which was fantastic. We have completed the analysis of that. The objective was really all about what planetary science investigations can be done from this framework. This is just, I think, the start of these kind of ideas. And we want to invest in them and really see if indeed there's any technology development that needs to be made to make them a reality. And then what are the anticipated cost range? There's a lot of anecdotal information about, you know, well, these are going to be real cheap, and indeed there's a variety that as you launch and put them in low Earth orbit, they are quite cost effective. It may not necessarily be true for planetary science. We're in a completely different regime. You know, we're either in the outer part of the solar system, you know, well away from Earth, or we're close to the sun. So there's also all different types of other considerations that we have to make. So we need to investigate that. So we have made these selections, 8 selections, 2 from Venus, Moon, asteroid, Mars, and icy bodies. And Christoph and Valerie have got missions to Venus. Suzanne and Tim, yeah. So if they're here, that's congratulate them. Asteroids, Jeff and Benton. Mars, David and Tony, and Cuneo and Robert for indeed icy bodies. So congratulations. These are the set out of the 102 that we've down selected. Now, it turns out we also have a number that we have identified and who have sent, or will be sending letters out for which we believe you're also selectable. And in that set, depending on the past budget, we're going to go back and perhaps fund several more of these. We'll just have to see what the past budget's all about. So after April 28th. So this is a huge step for us, and I think a start of an exciting opportunity for many of us in the field. Okay, I want to also talk about some new opportunities that we put in the ROSES call. As you all know, last year ROSES 16, New Frontiers Data Analysis Program, that was announced. May 3rd is when the proposals are due. In 17, which we released in February, we have now the Rosetta Data Analysis Program. We also have the OSIRIS-REx Participating Scientist Program. Both of those are extremely important. And as I mentioned earlier, we're also starting to work with heliophysics to create a participating scientist program for Juno. So we feel these are extremely important, and many of the ags also have given us findings that have told us this. And in fact, Louise Proctor has put together a group that's been studying participating scientist programs, how they've been managed, and how important they have been, and that hasn't fallen on deaf ears. So thank you very much for all those that are participating in that. Also, hopefully, with in a matter of days, we're going to release a new call. This is a mission of opportunity, an instrument that will go on JAXA's. You know, this is the Japanese Space Agency's mission, the Martian Moons Exploration Mission, MMX. and we're going to be soliciting a neutron and gamma ray spectrometer. So this is a sample return mission to Phobos, another really exciting opportunity to work with another agency in bringing our expertise in a very collaborative environment. So I'm really looking forward to getting that call out. Also, let me announce and thank the winners. We've selected four survey teams, four new survey teams. Jack Burns from the University of Colorado. I don't think Jack is here, but Amanda Hendricks is from PSI. Tom Orlando from Georgia Tech. And Alex Parker from SWRY out of Boulder. So congratulations to the new teams. See, it really helps when our budget goes up, right? Also, I want to point out something I've been harping on for a while, and now it's coming due, and that's JWST. You know, the Cycle 1 opportunities are coming up. This is a fabulous telescope, and it can track objects from Mars on out. Okay, so that's a pretty good chunk of the solar system, as you know. The early release science proposal, that call is... out with proposals due August 18, and also the Cycle 1 guest observer proposals, and those are due March 2nd of next year. But it's never too early to put together your teams right now and begin to think about how to use this fantastic telescope. Also, I want to encourage you to go to some of the planned workshops that Space Telescope Science Institute is supporting. For us directly, they're coming to the DPS, which will be in Provo, Utah this year in October, but also the AAS, and in fact, up at the Institute, they also have a number of workshops being planned, the most important one, Planning Solar System Observations with JWST in November, 13th through the 15th, at the Institute. So this is a tremendous asset. Once again, let me remind you that proposal call is once a year. The prime mission is only 5 years long, okay? You wanna get your proposals in the first cycle. The second cycle is going to contain not only new proposals that'll be accepted, but also follow-up from the previous cycle. You know, that's how it goes. And so your chances of breaking in on the second cycle goes down. And that's the same for the third, fourth, and fifth. So this is an important asset for us. It opens up not only a huge infrared wavelength regime for us that we can surely use, but the size of the telescope is really pretty spectacular. So once again, I encourage everyone that is even thinking about this to give it a shot. Now I want to talk very quickly about the rechartering of our advisory structure. Charlie Bolden, our administrator, who had been at NASA for a number of years and left in January 20th with the change of administration, before he left, he signed the rechartering of our advisory committees. But this also came in a new structure. So with a new structure, we're going to have to change the name. So instead of the Planetary Science Subcommittee, we're going to replace it with what we call the Planetary Advisory Committee, or the PAC. Now, instead of this committee reporting up and through Charlie, this committee will report directly to me. So this is a huge improvement. We really like this. The chair of the PAC will indeed be on Thomas Zurbuchen's committee, his advisory committee, so that's also quite important. And we're taking nominations right now, and you can self-nominate. You can nominate other people, but self-nomination is certainly okay. And the deadline for that is at the end of this month, March 31st. Now, the process, once we select people, they'll have to go through what's called the FACA process. And this is where one declares their financial interest and determines any conflicts of interest. This is a normal process that we have, but it can be onerous at times. We're going to also have to, under the new process, have FACA arrangements for each of our members of our senior reviews and also our science definition teams. Our analysis groups will still report into the PAC. They'll all be invited to the committee, and they'll all be expected to give a report of activities and findings that are occurring out in the community. So the basic structure that we have used for years is still in place, and there are some advantages, as I mentioned, to the new structure. Okay, I also now want to end by talking about the National Academy studies that are ongoing and new ones that are coming up. As I've already mentioned, we've charged and the Academy has completed the CubeSat review that came out in June of last year. They've also completed the extended missions review, and it was out of that review that they recommended that Congress put into law a three-year senior review, and now that report's already had its effect, so that's been really fantastic, great step for us. The RNA restructuring review is coming to an end. That report is due to us, and I believe it'll be on time in April. That's currently what they're targeting. Would have been great if it was out so that you can grill John Rawl tomorrow, right, or Wednesday at the town hall, but no, you have to wait. We also asked them to do a large strategic mission review. What is the importance of those, and are they part of the balance, and how are they part of our balance in terms of our small, medium, and once again, our large missions? And that report is due by the end of this fiscal year, so August, September timeframe. We also charged them with the midterm. It's been 5 years since our last decadal, believe it or not. And their first meeting is now set. It's May 4th and 5th in the Washington, D.C. area. Now, what's great about that is all the previous reports, so that's the CubeSat, extended mission, the RNA restructuring, the large mission, strategic mission analysis will all be input into that midterm because we play a role. Planetary science has a major role in each one of those previous reports. Now, I have also tasked the Academy for a sample analysis and future investment strategy. This is to get some input from the Academy on what we believe is going to be a fabulous next decade of sample return and sample analysis, and we need to get ready for it. And it's not just about what NASA invests in. There's a number of countries that have made major investments in laboratory analysis tools and techniques, most notably Japan, England, France, and Germany have made major investments, and I'd like to try to form a team where we can actually trade capabilities and open up some of our analysis of samples and use existing capabilities from other nations. So I'm seeking guidance from the National Academy on what the next set of steps to do, so that we can make our investments go as far as we can and improve our posture for the best analysis of the samples that we're bringing back in this next decade. The CAPS committee, this is our standing committee from the National Academy, they're meeting actually next week in Washington, D.C. And all these meetings have open times, so please log on to the Academy website and check the schedule so for any meetings you might be interested in. And then finally, the third planetary decadal, we will give them the charge by the end or close to the end of 2019, and then after a couple years worth of work, we'll get started on the next decadal. And so, with that, although I'm not going to take questions just yet, I think the plan is for me to introduce Ben Bussey. And Ben is the project scientist in human exploration. So Ben will come up and give us his take of what's happening on in HEOMD.
I used to think the worst thing that could happen at a conference was standing between people and freedom. I now realize the worst thing is standing between 500 interested people and questions for Jim. So I will be mercilessly brief. So I'm just going to touch upon a handful of things to get people realizing some of the activities that HEO has either ongoing or coming up that will represent interesting science scientific opportunities. And I can either purpose is just to get you leaving here realizing that there might be opportunities coming up in the near future that you could be thinking about now. So first, the one most of you are probably most familiar with is the Mars 2020 mission. Three of those instruments are supported by HEOMD. There's the Mars Oxygen ISRU experiment, MOXIE, which will extract oxygen out of the atmosphere. The idea is to return information that helps us plan on a larger scale system. Right now, from the human side, atmospheric ISRU is the primary ISRU that we're thinking about that we will use as part of the architecture of having humans on Mars. There's the Mars Environmental Dynamics Analyzer, MEDA. This is with our coming out of Spain. This is a weather station that also will monitor the Martian dust aerosol cycle. And finally, joint with the science and STMD, the Technology Mission Directorate, we have the Mars Entry, Descent, and Landing Instrumentation 2, MEDLI 2, which consists of sensors embedded in the thermal protection system that will provide information on Mars entry, descent, and landing to help us design the systems that you use when you go up to larger scale vehicles. Next, I'd like to talk about an opportunity that we're undertaking with the Korean space agency, CARI, called the Korea Pathfinder Lunar Orbiter, KPLO. CARI is planning a series of lunar exploration missions, beginning with KPLO and then following up by a second orbiter and a lander. And they have offered NASA the opportunity to fly payload on this orbiter, which we're very happily doing, and also to participate in joint science teams. So both the NASA science teams and the CARI science teams will have members from the other communities. And in fact, Jim Group, we've been working with Jim to talk about doing a participating scientist program in order for on the US side to get people involved and to do that before launch. So we intend to fly one or two instruments to acquire data that will address the strategic knowledge gaps. We had an RFI a little over a year ago that really helped us shape the provided really key information on the scope of instruments that would be proposed, and then we had the AO last September, and the review process is ongoing, and we're intending to make an announcement in roughly the next 4 to 6 weeks. Next, something slightly different, we have Lunar Catalyst. This is a Space Act agreement for 3 years. It started in 2014. It's no exchange of funds, but the idea is to help the bunch of commercial entities who are interested in sending small landers to the lunar surface. And this is a way for NASA to share its expertise to help that come to fruition. And the three partners that were selected were Astrobotic, Masten Space Systems, and Moon Express. Related to this, we recently had the Small Lunar Surface Payload RFI, and that was to help us assess from the community when these systems do become online and with their expected capabilities, what are the type of instruments that you all can provide that would help us to get the information that we want on strategic knowledge gaps. Oh, the animation worked. Yay. On the exploration EM-1 mission, we will be actually taking 13 CubeSats, and the one that's liked least by the other 12 is omitted first, and then the other 12 run free. And so what's important here is to see that this is a very interesting opportunity from the first SLS launch. And so there are several of these CubeSats are HEOMD-funded, Flashlight, Near-Earth Asteroid Scout, BioSentinel. And then you have, there are SMD ones with Lunar Map and CUSP, and you also have some provided by international partners and also the STMD directorate. And not only will these acquire good data in themselves, but they will also be testing technologies that then get fed back into the CubeSat community to help with future opportunities. And we've already been thinking about, you know, as EM2 and follow-on missions come online, they will provide, they'll carry an Orion, but they will always have likely have significant spare mass capacity. And CubeSats are only one of the secondary payloads that we've been looking at. We also had an RFI late last year for larger scale payloads going up to 6,000 kilograms to get a feel for what's out there that might want to be flown. So a little bit on the habitation. HEOMD's plan for human exploration after ISS to go further into the solar system is a deep space hab in the lunar vicinity. And by that, I mean either in lunar orbit or around one of the Lagrangian points. The first step of this was called Next Step Phase 1, and this involved tasking the international partners the commercial partners who proposed concepts, and this phase lasted just over a year. And then we've moved on to Phase 2, and this time now we have five companies as well as a concept study from Nanorax and Ixium, and they're actually going to produce ground prototypes. And NASA is looking at what a deep space hub would consist of, which is likely we're working with international partners, and we're also trying to consider how commercial fits into this for the overall system. And for those thinking, why is the fool talking about a hab? He's meant to talk about science. The reason I mention it is because it will allow science. And this is my last slide, and then you can have all your questions, but not to me. We've been working with the international partners to think about, as we start to explore further into the solar system, what science will be enabled by those missions, either because of the presence of the crew themselves or because of the presence of the infrastructure associated with the crew. And this is resulting in a... we've been working on a white paper that's actually been written by the international community. Several of you in the room have helped significantly for this. And this is actually sort of from the white paper showing the types of things that the international community have come up with. Perhaps of most interest for the people in the room are what we've had here listed as the additional... ambidextrous both sides. Additional science opportunities. And these reflect... sort of opportunistic science, a science that you'll be able to do because you have the hab there. You wouldn't necessarily need the crew involved. And the examples include things like astronomical observations, fundamental physics, collecting interplanetary material, heliophysics. And we've put it here in bold at the bottom. It's, you often get pushback from some communities when you talk about doing these kind of things. And the idea here, this isn't meant to replace you taking measurements with free-flying spacecraft. This is, we want to investigate, I've phrased it here, the lunar vicinity may not be your ideal location, but if this infrastructure exists, does it provide an opportunity for you perhaps to take some portion of the data that you'd like to take either sooner or cheaper because the infrastructure exists? And we're just setting up a process which will hopefully lead with a workshop where we want to involve the community now to tell us what types of instruments would you consider flying if you had regular upmast or a hab such as this. And that then feeds into SMD and HEOMD and STMD, so we're prepared. So when this thing exists, we know what type of instruments you want to fly. And with that, back to Jim.
Okay, thank you very much, Jim and Ben. That was excellent. We've also asked Jonathan Wall to join us on the podium, just in case you have any RNA questions that you can't hold until the RNA Town Hall on Wednesday. So, mics on either side of the room. I do not see anyone at them, so clearly that was crystal clear, and everyone's very happy. Everything is good. Oh, here we go. Yes.
Clifford Carley, no affiliation. Of all the planets in the solar system, there's only one that NASA has spent, rightfully so, a big part of its attention, and it's the one that we're standing on. My question is about the cutbacks that I've heard that are going to be happening in Earth research, specifically as it relates to anthropomorphic climate change, which NASA, I am proud to say, has been a world leader in the research of. So what comments do you have to address that?
So indeed, NASA's budget's been released, and in that budget, Earth science has a $100 million decrease from FY16. That's the president's proposed budget for earth science.
How does that address climate change research specifically?
Well, you know, earth science is following the earth science decadal and will continue to do so.
Okay, so I think we need to be, speaking a little closer to the microphone. Right. Clive Neal.
It is on. Clive Neal, Notre Dame. Couple of questions, and they should be reasonably brief, but first one is to Jim and Ben. With SpaceX actually making the announcement that they're going to orbit the moon next year, have you explored science and exploration opportunities for payloads to go into that either the far side of the moon, COMSAT, that would enable more detailed exploration of the far side, or any other explorations? You talked about Mars 2020. I'm wondering about Moon 2018.
So right now, no, I don't think there's been any significant discussion with them, because I don't think they've provided any hard details on the expected capability of the spacecraft. Once we know what their capabilities are and whether they have spare mass, then yes, we would talk to them and see what those opportunities might be. If it's a single Apollo 8 loop around the moon and come home, that's a very different scientific opportunity than if they go to orbit for a while.
Right, right. So the details just aren't available, but hopefully they will be. Well, they better be available soon. just a quick one for Ben. With the next HAB, are the international partners talking about lunar lander capability as part of that next HAB? Is HEOMD considered that?
No. Right now, the plan is just looking at designing a deep space HAB, I said, in the lunar vicinity. What you do with that HAB is a function of your agency priorities. Right now, NASA's stated goal is to go from a deep space HAB to learn the technologies that we need to go on to Mars. Other agencies, if they choose to do so, could look at doing a lunar lander staging from that HAB. But right now, the idea is to design something that would be useful to all.
Okay. Thank you.
Julie Rothman, I think you're next.
Okay. Julie Rothman, PSI. I wanted to thank NASA for starting to collect demographic information on the NSPIRE system.
Trick to that is you got to fill it out.
That's what I was going to mention. There was a note that came out in the PEN, the Planetary Exploration Newsletter, and also it was an OPAG finding that's encouraging more people to fill it out. So if you're not familiar with it, go find the PEN. I think it's also going to come out in the DPS mailing. It'll tell you exactly how to fill it out. So please, everybody in the room, fill that out.
John Kristoff, Arizona State University. So my question concerns the education cuts. Speaking for myself, I would not be here today in this career track, let alone in this conference room, if it weren't for NASA Space Grant. And given that the education office is seeing its funding cut, we in the scientific community are going to have to do more outreach and educational efforts to ensure that all the students out there continue to have the same educational opportunities they have, whether it's pre-kindergarten or post-grad. My question is, what is NASA headquarters prepared to do to support that?
Well, in the Science Mission Directorate, we indeed also lost our funding a couple years ago. But under John Grunsfeld's leadership, he put together a new plan. It's being led by Kristen Erickson. A cooperative agreement was let, and there's 19 groups that have been selected and are now starting to work and connect to our subject matter experts in each one of our mission teams. So we were also under review, and we didn't have the metrics to back up what was happening and how good the program really is. We've stepped back. We've created a new approach that actually will gain us the right metrics for us to understand and move the program and migrate it to continue to improve over time. And so I think we've made really great steps to be able to hang on to our educational funding.
Nathan?
What is the status and timeline of the potential next Mars orbiter after 2020?
So what we'll have to do is wait until all the budget details are released, which will be, as I mentioned, probably in the May timeframe. In addition to that, Congress will also be passing its budget, so I think a lot of information will be coming out concerning activity at Mars, which would help support not only our NASA's current program, but also enable us, I believe, to connect more effectively with some of the commercial entities that are working in that direction, as I mentioned earlier.
Okay, Candy?
Candy Hansen, PSI. With the latest round of discovery selections, it's starting to look like the discovery program is really appropriate for small bodies, and that pushes a lot of the bigger places and more distant places all into new frontiers and flagship missions. So I'm wondering if, looking forward into the future, if there's any possibility for a more flexible arrangement of resources so that it's not strictly so many discoveries and so many new frontiers, but maybe the possibility to trade two discoveries for one new frontiers.
Ooh, sounds complicated to me, but it's easy. well, we're following the planetary decadal, in which it's well delineates that the discovery program is an open competition, and in that open competition, you know, we work hard to promote a variety of mission concepts that come in, and select the top missions to move forward. So the next decadal survey, which will be charged to the Academy in mid to late 2019, will start that process of delineating what are the steps that they need to do to continue the program. And I'm sure they will look quite hard at the kinds of activities for small, medium, and large missions. I'm sure they'll be talking about a balanced program. That's what seems to be coming out in not only the extended mission, but CubeSat area, and also from the strategic large mission area. So I would expect the program to largely continue. So the flexibility will be in the competition. Well, the resource trade, once again, will be relative to what happens in the community relative to looking back over the decade and seeing how well we did and what we need to do to be able to move into the next decade. So your input is going to be just as important as any other input into that decadal process.
Robert Nelson, Planetary Science Institute. I wanted to thank the first questioner for bringing up the most important question, which was the potential that the new administration will be deciding we don't need to know the information about environmental change that is about to be cut off, and particularly the issue of cutting off spacecraft such as OCO-3. And while I thank the questioner for asking you to transmit that upstairs, I know some of you quite well and know that you will do that. But that's not the point. We can't expect you to do that because that's not your legally defined job. The legally defined job is everyone in this room. And I want to remind you that if you do participate in the American Geophysical Union meeting, and even if you don't, you should look online for the remarks of Governor Jerry Brown to the last AGU meeting, where he made the very interesting statement, if California is the eighth largest state in the union, and if the government cuts off the environmental monitoring satellites, California will launch its own damn satellites. That's a direct quote from Jerry Brown. But that also means that everyone in this room needs to understand that we've delivered the message to our NASA friends who manage our programs, and we have to trust that they will do what they can on the inside. but that all of us need to go home and not to fool around anymore. You need to Google on who your member of Congress is, who your state representatives are, and you need to let them know from a scientific perspective the appalling prospect that that budget means for environmental science. And that's a job that all of us have to do. This is not the time to say, let somebody else do it. Jim Green's going to do the best job he can. But we have to do our job. And if you haven't done it, then it's better not to ask those kinds of questions. You can write an article in your community newspaper. You can write articles in your city and statewide newspaper. Do not miss this responsibility. If you want to do this kind of work, you have to take the responsibility to fight for it. Thank you very much.
Bryce Hanshaw from George West. My question is, if y'all are going to launch to Mars and beyond, is it a possibility in y'all's plans that y'all are going to build a moon base for like a pit stop to restock, deliver, or in case there's any things that need to be fixed, repair it at a moon base before launching onto other planets?
This is why you kept it between us. So right now, the NASA architecture involves the Deep Space Hab in lunar orbit, and from there going straight to Mars system, Mars orbit, possibly the Mars moons, and then the Mars surface. The current NASA plans don't involve going to the lunar surface before going on to Mars. Some of our international partners look into doing it a different way. So the question is, there may be lunar surface, like you say, it may not be NASA's.
Okay, Elise?
Hello, Elise Harrington, University of Western Ontario. So while I'm sure we are excited by the allocation towards planetary science, as mentioned by previous commenters, there is concerns about the cuts to earth science and environmental science. As sort of like a damage control prospect, is there any possibility in using some of the planetary science budget for terrestrial analog studies and perhaps kill two birds with one stone by studying our planet, using our planet to study other planets?
So we do that all the time. For instance, in astrobiology, the activity that we're looking for life in extremes, that wasn't done by earth science, that was done by planetary scientists. We have a lot of crater analogs. The Survey Institute does a lot of work in that particular area. So we anticipate we're going to continue to do that, you know, and fund those activities that are important to make comparative climatology a reality. We're working on the third workshop in comparative climatology, and that involves all the disciplines, earth science, astrophysics, heliophysics, and planetary science. And that's coming along really great.
And just to add on to that, if the budget allows, we will have a comparative climatology call at some point in the future. So that will be cross-divisional. So.
That is excellent. Thank you very much.
Is the microphone? Maybe you could come up to this one. Thank you.
Carl Allen, JSC Emeritus. For both Jim and Ben, could you comment on the nominal asteroid redirect mission?
All yours, Ben.
Yep. So
it's gone.
That's right.
Do you not want the answer? Oh, there he is.
I do want the answer.
So you would have seen the note in the one page that came out for the 18 presidential budget, talked about the asteroid redirect mission not happening. As you also know, the way the system works is that goes to Congress, and what we do will depend upon what we get appropriated. Right now, we have had two recent solicitations for both instruments and to be members of the instrument teams. Those are both ongoing. So, yeah, we all read the same sentence in the from the White House direction, we won't really know exactly what is happening until we see the appropriations bill.
Thank you.
Lucy.
Lucy McFadden, I'm serving as the chair for the American Astronomical Society Division of Planetary Sciences this year. And I would, to follow on in the vein of Robert Nelson, I would bring your attention to an action alert from our Federal Relations Subcommittee that went out on Friday evening, a few days ago, calling on members of the Division for Planetary Sciences to notify their congressmen, inform them about the position of the president's budget, and to support our efforts to continue planetary science and have it healthy in our budget, and to support Jim Green and what he's done in bringing our planetary science budget up to where the president is asking for it. So please look in your emails from last Friday. There's a long, lengthy instruction, and we're trying to target informing our congressman this week. Thank you.
Hi, Renee Weber from NASA Marshall. I was wondering if you know whether Simplex will be solicited, and if it is, where it will go and when.
Well, right now we don't have the budget to support the Simplex call. What we'd like to do is wait for these newly awarded missions and CubeSat concepts to run its course before we release the call for Simplex. So it could be late in the ROSA's 2017 year, or it could be in 2018.
Okay, thank you.
Nancy.
Yeah. I guess this is not so much a question for you guys, and I'll apologize for that ahead of time, but since everybody else is doing it.
Go, Nancy.
I personally feel that it's very short-sighted to be excited about this planetary science budget, because planetary science does not live in isolation of the rest of the science community in this country. So I would temper your enthusiasm a little bit. And I would also really encourage you, Lucy, and the DPS in particular, to modify what we should be asking of our congressmen, because we cannot just be supporting planetary science. This will be short-term gain, potentially, but a long-term loss if the science community in the United States is not strong everywhere all around. And Jim, you very nicely presented the overall perspective of that budget from the Washington Post, and it's good. And that message, I hope the DPS and our professional communities will consider taking that larger message forward. So please consider that in our professional communities. Thank you.
Hi, Jake Robbins from the We Martians podcast. Dr. Green, you mentioned that there's sort of a golden age of sample return kind of coming down the pipe. With this nice budget, I was wondering if you have any update on how we're going to get the Mars 2020 samples back home.
So there are indeed a variety of architectures that are being studied. And in fact, we're going to be talking about this directly next week at the CAPS meeting. But I didn't have an opportunity to really go into great detail about it. But indeed, it will be budget dependent. And we'll see what the president's budget as the further details are released. But we're working on some key technologies and making some great progress in those areas.
Michael. This is for Jim Green.
Whoa.
And I almost, sorry. I'll be here all week, folks. All right, I'm Michael Paul from the Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Lab, and I'd like to know if there's gonna be an AO anytime soon for the Europa Lander instruments.
So the Europa Lander is at really a concept phase. And how that goes, of course, is indeed you have a science definition team. They go through the analysis. We're rolling that out. It's all in discussion phase. So we haven't really entered what we would call formulation, which would be a key decision point A, KDPA, we typically call it. So we have a ways to go before that becomes a reality. But it's not in the president's budget for 18.
Not for 18. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. It looks like we are out of questions. Let's thank our speakers once again. I'd like to remind you that the opening of the exhibits, I think, is downstairs right now with food, I believe. And don't forget, there's a free showing of Hidden Figures tomorrow night, courtesy of USRA. Oh, sorry, Wednesday night. I'm already a day ahead. 9 p.m. Wednesday.